Hello there, and welcome to the audio and microphone lecture for GHS's Video Productions Level 1 class. This is lecture number 3. So we're going to be talking about audio today. And in order to really understand how microphones work, we really need to know how audio or sound actually works. So an object that's making sound, whether it's a mouth, whether it's something falling, whether it's a speaker playing somewhere, that's going to cause the air molecules around it to vibrate. That creates a pattern of that vibration that moves through the air, and it eventually gets to our ears. The ear funnels that down, and it eventually hits our eardrum. And so the eardrum senses those molecules moving. It's really the pressure that those molecules are pushing against our eardrum, and so our eardrum kind of flexes in and out, and that in turn transmits a signal to our brain. So microphones really do the same thing. They receive that acoustic energy, those molecules that are moving, and they convert it into electrical energy, just like our ear and our eardrum kind of transmits that electronically to our brain. Once it receives that sound and converts it into an electrical signal, then we can actually modify it, we can amplify it, we can record it, we can do all kinds of different things with that electrical signal. Now, there are different types of microphones. There are very inexpensive microphones, they're very expensive microphones. They come in all shapes and sizes, and they do a lot of different things. So it's really important to understand how we characterize microphones, how we talk about microphones, and what microphone might be right for you. So there are 4 main criteria that we describe mics by. The first is physical design, what its actual shape is. The second is directionality, that's in which way it receives the sound waves. There's also the transducer type, so how it actually converts that sound wave and changes it into an electrical signal. And then, of course, there's electrical impedance, which we'll get into a little bit more later because it's technical. So when we talk about physical design, there's kind of 4 main types. There's handheld ones. There's lavalier microphones that are also called tie microphones or lapel mics. And then there are surface mount microphones as well as shotgun mics. And we'll use those a lot. So this is what a standard handheld one looks like. You see people singing with it. It has kind of a little screen over it. This acts as a pop filter. It's a mild pop filter, so a lot of people will use a pop filter on top of that. And a pop filter basically blocks the P's and the T sounds that we make when we're talking. And some people will create a very loud popping sound when they say their P's and T's. And a pop filter can reduce that a bit. Now, the lavalier mics, these are, again, those lapel mics or tie mics, and they'll typically have a little clip with them, and we can clip those onto something, normally clothing, a necklace, a tie, part of your coat, whatever. And you can also tape them directly onto your subject. So you can use gaffer's tape or another type of tape that doesn't leave a horrible residue and sticks to your subject fairly well. And then that way they can move around with it. There's also surface mount ones. These are great if you're needing to record something without super high quality, but you want lots of people to be heard. This really receives sound from all around it. And so a lot of the times for conferences or for a telephone conversation, people will set one of these in the center of the table. That way they can pick up all of the actors or all of the people that are around it. And this is one of our shotgun mics. This one is great. We use it with most of our smaller handheld cameras. And you'll notice that it kind of has a long tube shape there at the top. It also has a foam windscreen on it, as well as a flex cord that will then plug it into the camera. Now, with directionality, we're actually talking about how the microphone receives audio. So, with an omnidirectional microphone, obviously omni means all, so this is going to be received from all directions around it. A unidirectional microphone, uni means one, so that's going to be only receiving it ideally from one direction. Now here you can kind of see the reception bubble for this microphone. You can see the microphone there in the center, kind of looks like an ice cream cone. And then there's kind of this heart shape that runs around it. And this is what we talk about when we're talking about directionality. You can see the person pretend that they're talking and their sound waves are moving away from their mouth towards the microphone. The microphone's gonna pick up the majority of its sound from straight in front of it. But it can also, in this one, pick up from the side and even a little bit from the back. Now, that's called a pickup pattern. And so here are four different pickup patterns that we'll typically see. The third one from the left we'll actually talk about first. That's the omnidirectional. And the omnidirectional picks up its audio equally from all directions. Again, that tabletop microphone is an omnidirectional microphone, so it's going to pick up all of the actors equally. The cardioid one, which is in the far left, that's the basic heart shape pattern that we saw before. It's going to get most of it from in front. It'll get a little bit from the sides and very little from the back. This is great if you want to avoid camera sound, because sometimes your camera will actually be making sound, and we don't want to get that in the recording. Now, the cardioid is considered unidirectional. Ideally, it's coming mostly from one. Now, if you imagine squishing that heart shape down from the sides, you can end up with the more unidirectional microphone, which is in the far right. And that one picks up audio really from one direction, and that's mostly right in front. It will pick up a little bit around the sides of it and just a little bit in the back. And then there's hypercardioid, where it's squished even more towards the back. So it kind of picks up a little bit more from the back, as well as that general pattern in front of it and slightly to the side. Now, when you actually have the insides of the microphone, the guts inside it, that's going to be where those sound waves go into it and are converted into an electrical energy. So that piece inside is called a transducer. Some people also call it a cartridge, and you'll see from the picture soon exactly why they call it a cartridge. But different types of transducers convert sound different ways. So here is a dynamic microphone. This is one that a lot of people like to sing with. And it's largely copper wire wrapped around a magnet. And that copper wire, which is called a coil, is going to receive the vibrations from the diaphragm that's right in front of it. And as sound waves hit that diaphragm, just like our eardrum, it's going to flex in and out based on the pressure. And that is going to convert it into the electrical signal, run through those wires, and head back to the cord, wherever that's going to. Now, with the condenser mic, this one is more like the lavalier microphones, and it has a much more sensitive diaphragm in the front. A lot of the times it will be a ceramic diaphragm. Some of the less expensive ones will be a small metal diaphragm or possibly a tin one. And it has a little back plate that it's going to vibrate against. This creates a very, very slight signal. It's very low in what you would consider to be volume. And so it requires a battery to amplify that sound up loud enough for us to be able to use that. So a condenser mic will almost always have a battery pack with it. It can be what it plugs into. It could also go into a mixer, which a mixer can actually send power to a microphone, and that's called phantom power. We'll talk about that a little bit more later. But here you can largely see what that diaphragm is and what it does. Now, phantom power, this, for people who DJ or use mixers in any way, will kind of normally see a phantom power button in the back. And when you turn that button on, it's going to send power out through the microphone cable to the microphone itself. And it's a great way to get power to those condenser mics if you don't want to use a battery pack. The difficulty is if you turn on phantom power with a dynamic mic, you'll get a really loud buzzing sound or a hum in that signal. So you really only want to use phantom power if it truly is a condenser microphone that needs to receive power. Most microphones will tell you whether it needs phantom power, and simply by turning on that phantom power button, you'll usually hear right away if it needs it or not. So here you can see one of the kits that we have. You can see in the upper left of the picture, there's a box, and this is a wireless transmitter that plugs into the bottom of a microphone. That sends its signal wirelessly to one of the receivers. If you look at the two small boxes to the right on the upper edge of the picture, you'll see that there are two that look almost identical. The one on the left is also a transmitter. We can plug that into like a lavalier microphone and have that on a person. This transmitter can clip on the back of them so that we can conceal the cord, and the signal will be received by the receiver that's in the picture on the right-hand side in the upper right corner. Looks very much like the basic transmitter, except it's got a couple different bars of LEDs on it so that we can see that it's receiving the signal, and we can see that that it's receiving the proper volume and the battery power is there. There's some cords that go along with this kit. There's also a mount in the lower right corner that connects onto the receiver, and that allows us to mount it to the top of a camera. And then using one of those two cords, we're going to send the signal from the receiver into the camera. So again, it goes from the microphone to one of the transmitters that wirelessly sends it to the receiver, and then the receiver sends it with a wire into the camera to be recorded on the tape or the media that's being used. Now, another important thing to know about is electrical impedance. And if you've had an electronics class, you would definitely experience these and go through learning about electrical impedance. But it's kind of the characteristic of audio equipment that describes the electrical aspect of it. So just like voltage or current that we use for electrical plugs and things like that, it's expressed in ohms. And that symbol for it looks like that little horseshoe shape. It's the ohm symbol. And there's low impedance and there's high impedance. With low impedance, we're talking about 600 ohms and less. It's also known as low Z or low impedance. So if you're buying a microphone and you want to get one that's low impedance, you definitely want to make sure to look on the package, make sure that it is registered as less than 600 ohms, or you can talk to the person at the store and they'll usually talk about it being low Z or low impedance. This is really all that we want to use. And for any sort of professional application or semi-professional or anything related to film, we want to use these low impedance microphones. They can be used with cables that run up to 1,000 feet. And 1,000 feet seems like a lot. But if you can imagine being in the gym at school or even in the theater, if there's a microphone that has a 20-foot cable and that plugs into the wall, and then there's wires in the wall that send that signal back to an audio booth or to a DJ mixer. And then there's another 20-foot cable that goes from the wall on the other side of the gym or theater into that mixer or that sound booth. So you can add up a lot of cable feet really quick by having those cables in the walls. And we don't really think about that when we're using a 20-foot cable. Now, high impedance will be registered at 10,000 ohms or more. It'll also be called high Z or high impedance. And this you can only use cables that are up to 20 feet in length. If you get longer than that, the sound will start to appear muffled. And these are things where if you buy like a karaoke machine or like a child's microphone that they can sing with, those type of things will have really short cables on them. And they'll definitely be high impedance. They're less expensive for obvious reasons. Now, we're always having issues with students understanding different cables and connectors. So we'll talk about them and we'll say, hey, grab me an XLR cable that is an XLR female on one side and a quarter inch male on the other for an adapter. And it takes a little while for students to get the hang of what those cables are. So here's some pictures that we'll look at. The common cables that we largely use in class are XLR, quarter inch, RCA, which is also known as the phono plug, and 3.5 millimeter mini plug. This is what the XLR looks like. It's typically a thicker cable, and it's going to have three plugs or three prongs in it. And one side is going to be the female portion. That's the one on the left. And the one on the right is going to be the male portion. Those snap into each other, and you can see that they'll connect. The quarter inch, you'll see this a lot of the time on electric guitars, on microphones, headphones that have a nice thicker cable, and a few other just basic connections that we'll use. But you can see that it's much thicker than the 3.5 millimeter mini plug that we would use on like your iPod or your phone may have a connection for the headset with this 3.5 millimeter mini plug. On the quarter inch, you can see that the male jack is up at the top. The female jack is down below. On the 3.5 millimeter mini plug, you can see that the male is on the left side and the female jack is on the right-hand side there. RCA or phono plug, this one I only have a set of males in the picture, but you can see that there's a red and a white. The red almost always is going to be right for the right channel, and white will be the left channel. So, mic and line inputs. What's really the difference? Students have a hard time understanding the difference between mic and line inputs, and I guess the simplest way to look at it is that a microphone input has much lower decibel levels or volume levels than a line input, and we don't want to mix those up. Line input is going to be amplified. It's an amplified signal, and it'll be much, much louder. And so, according to Shure, which is one of the microphone companies, microphone levels are usually specified between negative 60 and negative 40 decibels, and line level input is considered to be plus 4 decibels. So that's a huge difference. It's been amplified normally from a mixer or some other audio device. Now, if you're plugging it into a computer at home, whether it's plugging in your iPod or whether it's plugging in a microphone, you want to double check and make sure if your computer uses a line input or a mic input. And a lot will have both. Our computer actually automatically senses it. It's a mic and line input port. And so depending on what's being plugged into it, it will automatically sense that power and change itself between a line input and a mic input. So when you're adjusting audio levels, we'll use voltage units or a VU meter, and that's going to either be a needle type, which would be the old analog, and you'll see that on some of our mixers, or it'll be a series of light emitting diodes or just a simulated indicator like in Final Cut Pro here with the audio meter. With Final Cut Pro, we always want to make sure to adjust the audio levels so that they peak at negative 6. You'll notice that negative 6 there is just about where we're starting to get to the yellow. We don't want to get into the red at all because that can cause some distortion. So we want to try to keep it peaking right at negative 6. On the Canon HV20 cameras, you can also adjust it so that it's around negative 6 decibels. And you can see here on the little simulated indicator down below that it has negative decibels and it has 40 on one side and then it has 12 and 0. So you want it peaking, and that little grid as it goes up and down, we want it peaking between the 12 and the 0. And obviously that would be about 6. Setting those levels really is hugely important, especially when you're mixing projects together. When we make a master DVD of all of your projects, if students have set their levels so that one group is at negative 6, another group is at negative 18, another group is at negative 12, when people are watching it, as they go project to project, they're going to have to change the volume on their television set up and down. And just like when you're watching commercials and the commercial volume increases, it's kind of annoying. So we want to go ahead and make sure to have that be as easy for viewers as possible. And so we always want to set our levels to negative 6. Now, one of the final things is the 3-to-1 rule. And this is really the distance between open microphones if you're lucky enough to use multiple microphones. So if there's microphones that are all feeding into the same receiver, We want to make sure that those microphones are at least 3 times the distance away from each other as they are to the nearest source. So here we've got kind of a choir singing, and if the choir is 3 feet away from the microphones, we want to make sure that the microphones are 9 feet away from each other. That will help to reduce the echo that you can hear when one microphone is picking up the sound shortly after another microphone picks it up. And it can also help to eliminate various other noises and issues that we have. So just remember the 3-to-1 rule if you happen to be lucky enough to shoot with multiple microphones. And that is it for our audio microphone lecture number 3 for Video Productions 1. If you need to practice for the quiz or check anything, feel free to skim back and forth through the YouTube video, and I hope it helped you. Thanks a lot.